Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon. Good evening. I will share my screen. So my presentation is about the practice of extempore arranging and performing the repertoire of the great American songbook on carillon. The Great American Songbook does not refer to any actual book or specific list of songs. According to the Great American Songbook Foundation, the Great American Songbook is, quote, the canon of the most important and influential American popular songs and jazz standards from the early 20th century that have stood the test of time in their life and legacy. Unquote. The list of songs in the Great American Songbook includes haunting songs like If I Were a Bell, All the Things You Are, Blue Moon, I Got Rhythm, My Funny Valentine, and so on. They are melodies that are part of many people's musical memories and that deserve a permanent place in the repertoire of every carillonneur. According to me, there is a curious similarity between the Great American Songbook and the 18th century carillon books in terms of the repertoire, the use of the songbook carillon book, and the performance practice. From earlier research, it became clear that the 18th century carillon books are simply collections of popular music, dances, popular songs, etc., comparable with our contemporary songbooks. These 18th century carillon books do not contain any music that was specifically composed for the carillon. These carillon books clearly reflect the tastes of audiences from one region to another. I would like to point out that carillonneurs also selected melodies and themes from keyboard compositions by composers such as Couperin, Fiocco, Defèche. They chose these melodies because of their popularity and fame. And these melodies were also repinned on the barrels of the automatic carillons, where they resound like a real list of hits, often over many decades. La Folia, Une Jeune Fillette, Bergamesque, L'Angloise, to just name a few. The cover of De Gruyter's carillon book, Antwerp 1746, clearly shows the broad repertoire that was played. Just go back to the cover so you can see correnten, contradansen, allegros, preludes, menuets, etc. The notation in these carillon books, in these songbooks, can be very diverse. Sometimes there is only a melody. This is from the Prince carillon book. Sometimes there is a melody with letters beneath indicating the bass notes and in this way suggesting chords, as you can see in the menuet of Berghuis, booklet number 47. Sometimes there is a melody with a bass. Again, an opera aria in the carillon book of the Prince. Sometimes there is a melody with the bass and the harmonization. Here you see the beginning of an andante of Fiocco, which was included also in the carillon book of De Gruyter's. The notation in the Berghuis booklets in particular looks surprisingly modern and is reminiscent of the notation in many 20th century songbooks. You see here the melody of Berghuis, late 18th century, with letters indicating chords and bass. And this is Prelude to a Kiss by Duke Ellington, with also the melody and chord symbols. Actually, this is really the same. But one thing is clear. It is all about the melody. And a typical example is the beginning of the sonata in G major by Ludwig van Beethoven, which can be found in the Berghuis booklets. Here too, only the melody is noted with only letters indicating the bass notes. So the melody, which is quite well known, I think, yum, ba ba da ba ba da dum, bum, bim, bum, bam. And it's just the melody with, again, some letters indicating bass notes, indicating chords. And it was a carillonneur who has to perform it based on this notation. 18th century carillonneurs spontaneously adapted these melodies to the requirements of the carillon. And from my research, it became clear that their performance also consisted of extempore melodic embellishments, of changing the harmonic texture and the bass line, and of adding improvised introduction, so-called preludes. And I would like to remind you that these insights emerge from a comparative analysis of the repinning manuscripts with the pieces in the carillon box. In other words, the barrels of the 18th century carillons did act as giant CD players playing the popular repertoire of their time. And they also inform contemporary carillonneur researchers about the performance practices of their 18th century colleagues. As an example, I show you the beginning of Jocko's Langlois, as noted in the Gruyter's carillon book at the top right, and in his repinning manuscript. And you can see that he added an introduction, and that he also added some, for example, here you have an upbeat, this scale, and he also did wrote some inégalité, etc. So the automatic carillon does inform us about the performance practice of 18th century carillonneurs. So the conclusion of the research project was that the performance practice of 18th century carillonneurs was a mix of extempore transcribing, arranging, and improvising. It is, as I like to call it, real musicianship. That, as it became clear from my PhD research, was also a common practice in the 17th century, be it that other practices were used, in particular the extempore playing of intabulations, including the art of playing diminutions. Contemporary musicians, very often jazz performers, who explore the repertoire of the great American songbook, apply the exact same performance practices as carillonneurs in the 18th century. They also add intros, play variations on the melody, adapt chords, change harmonic progressions, etc., etc. So the Gruyter's carillon book has now been replaced by one of the many songbooks, such as Hits for Buskers, The Real Book, etc. Here too, it is all about the melodies that belong to the collective musical memory of many. Andantes and arias become haunting ballads. Allegros and gavottes become swinging standards. Moreover, an analysis of the musical parameters, melody, rhythm, harmony, structure, an analysis of the standards in the Great American Songbook shows that there are striking similarities with the pieces in the 18th century carillon books. And within the scope of this presentation, I just would like to focus mainly on the harmonic aspect. In the 18th century, the so-called classical Western harmony was at the same time, it formed the underlying basis from which melodies arose and which, with which they were strongly connected. Essentially, the songs of the Great American Songbook are still based on this Western classical harmonic model. A theme like Fly Me to the Moon is based on the same harmonic sequence as the middle movement from the Fish Cavotte from the Gruyter's Carillon book. You can see here a fragment from the Cavotte by the Fish with the harmonic structure, the harmonic progression. And this is exactly the same harmonic progression as the beginning of Fly Me to the Moon. I just record these fragments on my carillon in moll, and I would like you to listen to it. So, same harmonic structure, progressions, different melody. Here you see the so-called double of the same passage of the Fish, where he is making a variation on the melody, which in some way you can consider to be a written, a notated improvisation. And of course, this is based on the same harmonic scheme, and you can also improvise on the harmonic scheme of Fly Me to the Moon. I just let you listen to it. Also, chromatic chord progressions, as they appear, for example, in the beautiful Andante by Fiocco, can also be implied, for example, in the beginning of Ain't Misbehaving. This is a fragment from the Andante by Fiocco, a very beautiful piece. This is the fundamental bass, the chromatic bass, based on the idea of secondary dominance. And that's exactly the same harmonic progression with secondary dominance you can apply on the beginning of Ain't Misbehaving. I also let you listen to these fragments. From the Fiocco, I made a kind of resume, so it's not exactly what you see. This harmonic progression is used also in Ain't Misbehaving. To be able to work creatively with a repertoire from the Great American Songbook as a carillonneur, a thorough knowledge of this Western classical harmony is necessary. From an analysis of the melody, in combination with an insight into the harmonic structure, the carillonneur can perform a song of the Great American Songbook in the same way as he would perform pieces from the 18th century carillon books. He usually starts with an intro and then brings the melody with the bass line, supplemented with a coloring harmonic tone, here and there, after which he improvises over the basic material. In the same way that carillonneurs from the 17th and 18th centuries could learn and practice how to play diminutions, how to improvise on the basis of partimenti, or how to deliver a basso continuo extempore, carillonneurs who want to work with the songs from the Great American Songbook can also practice patterns that allow them to play melodic variations, typical harmonic progressions, over typical harmonic progressions, such as the 2-5-1 progression. You see here an example from the end of the 16th century, how to learn to play diminutions. These are just patterns. That's just exactly the same thing as what jazz musicians do, but what also clarinetists can do when they want to learn to improvise on, for example, a 2-5-1 pattern. Of course, the clarinetist must take into account the idiomatic characteristics of his instrument. Chords and harmonic progressions are, on a carillon, displayed much more effectively in a horizontal, linear way than in a vertical, chordic way. In other words, a carillonneur is best inspired by Bach's partitas for solo violin or the compelling guitar improvisations of Dupas, rather than by Bach's harpsichord suites or Bill Evans' genius piano improvisation. To put it clear, on a carillon, it's, I think, better to display a D flat major chord in a linear way, suggesting the chord, than if you would play it, try to imitate the piano, beautiful piano progressions of Bill Evans. In any case, it appears that the Great American Songbook enables carillonneurs to enlarge substantially their repertoire. And by doing so, they can replace or complete the Gruyter's carillon book with the Great American Songbook. Each carillonneur can compose his or her own Great American carillon book in the same way as the Gruyters, the Prince, Dupont, or Berghuis did. Starting from their own collection of haunting melodies, they can play creative extemporary performances to the delight of all. And to conclude, I will just show you a short recording. I made an improvisation on Ain't Misbehaving, showing, or I hope making much more clear what I was trying to explain you. Thank you for your attention. I will unshare my screen.